Hello everyone, welcome to this video. My name is Chris Greer with Packet Pioneer. Just wanted to take a minute to shoot a video about TCP. Now, something I do get a lot of questions about is how does TCP work? What are some of the functions that it does? What are sequence and acknowledgement numbers? How do retransmissions work? So I thought it might be nice to start a video series about TCP, and I'm gonna call it TCP Fundamentals. Not sure exactly how many videos in this series there will be, but we'll go ahead and get started. And one of the most core things we need to understand, or one of the fundamental things that it's important to understand about TCP is how TCP connections are initiated. So in this video, we're gonna tackle the TCP handshake and take a look at what we can learn from that whole process. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. So the first thing I'm gonna do in this trace file is I'm gonna go down and find the initial packet of the TCP three-way handshake. And that is a TCP Syn. So let's go ahead and scroll down and find the TCP Syn. Here we go. And that has been selected already in my packet summary up there. So I can see that my source IP 10.0.0.145 is trying to connect to that destination server there. And the port that I'm trying to hit is port 80. Okay, so the two following packets, I can see there that those are ARPs. So rather than dig into ARP right now, what I wanna do is just filter those out. So one of the first things you wanna do when you're doing TCP connection analysis and you just wanna filter on a single TCP connection, let's go ahead and right click and we're gonna come down to conversation filter. And the conversation filter that I wanna set is not Ethernet, not IPv4, because that would be show me all TCP connections between these two IP addresses. I actually want to come down to TCP. So I want to set a TCP level filter for this connection. So what that does is it isolates it nice and cleanly for me and shows me just the packets that are involved in this connection. As we can see up top, the first three packets that are involved here are the TCP handshake. So the client is initiating a SYN, that's a TCP synchronized packet, to our server on port 80. So let's go ahead and take a look at that SYN and see what we can learn. We're gonna bring up our packet details, and we're gonna come down to the TCP part of the header, and let's go ahead and talk through this. So our source port, there's our client-side ephemeral port, destination port, port 80. Now stream index. Now Wireshark will assign each TCP connection that it sees in the trace file a stream index number. It'll start at 0 and then it'll go up to however many connections there are in the trace file. So I can see that this is the second one that it saw in this trace file. If I wanted to, I could just choose to filter on this TCP stream and use that index number. That's one way I could filter for it. Down below, I can see my sequence number is 0. So initially, when a connection is being established, this sequence number, in Wireshark, I'm using relative sequence numbers. But in reality, if I select that part of the header and I look down below at my hexadecimal, this is really a 4-byte value. So this is a long, confusing number in reality. Wireshark is just trying to make it easier on me. As a human being, I do a whole lot better starting things at 0 than I do 100 million, blah, 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 whatever that number would be. Just a long, complex number to begin with. So as a human being, I'm a lot better with starting at 0. That's why I use relative sequence numbers, which is the default setting in Wireshark. Okay, so, but the function here is I am communicating that number to my link partner. I'm telling you, hey, Mr. Server, this is the sequence number that I am beginning with. So go ahead and track everything that I sent you starting from this sequence number. This is our 0 point. Now if I come down here, header length, let's go to flags. This is another important part of our TCP handshake. We have reserve, congestion window, echo. I'm gonna cover these in a different specific video on how we use those and what we do. Right now I'd like you to come down to the SYN. This is the only bit that is set for the TCP flags. So that means SYN true. That's the function of this packet, is to synchronize that sequence number and a handful of other things. If we come down to window size, this is where I am advertising the size of my TCP receive buffer. I'm telling my link partner I can receive 8,192 bytes at once, unacknowledged. That's the amount that I can receive at once. Now calculated window size, If in my TCP options, I'm using window scaling, that means that I actually can multiply this number, 8192, I can use a multiplier to make that window size a whole lot bigger. Because if I select window size value, I can see down below, if I look at the hexadecimal down below, this is a 2-byte field. So just the decimal number, the biggest number that I can get, that I can actually have for a TCP buffer just using this field, is 65535. That's all we can get over 2 bytes. So in order to get more than that, in order to have a TCP receive buffer that's larger than 65535, I have to use that TCP option of having a window scale. Now that's something that was added to the original TCP spec in the TCP options RFC, and that allows us to receive a whole lot more data at once, allowing us to take advantage of higher latency, higher bandwidth WAN connections, typically longer connections where we wanna have a lot more data on the pipe. Okay, and that's again something else that we're gonna cover in our TCP fundamentals later on. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at our options. Let's expand this. So here we can see the MSS, maximum segment size, is 1460. I'm telling my link partner, hey, that's the amount of bytes that you can put in a TCP segment, and I'm okay with that. Now, along the path from the source to the destination, it is possible that a network infrastructure device, maybe to make room for WAN acceleration or some other type of thing in the middle, it's possible that a router even could change this. It could say, hey, you know, 1460, I need some of that headroom, so let's go ahead and kick this down to 1448, and then we'll use that as our maximum segment size. Okay, now we have the window scale. So this is showing us a window scale 2, so that's gonna tell me to multiply by 4. I'm telling my link partner, take my window size, multiply it by 4, and that's the real deal. So you're gonna see that as we move a little bit farther forward in our TCP connection, you'll see how that'll impact our calculated window size. Also TCP SAC, so selective acknowledgement. I'm letting my link partner know this is something that I can do, so go ahead and let me know if you can do it. And this is a great function in TCP, certainly something we'll be covering in our TCP fundamentals. All right, so there's our SYN. This is advertising some of our capabilities, some of the things we want to do with this connection, and of course, it's sending our starting sequence number to our link partner. Now there's one other small thing we want to mention that happens with a TCP SYN. If I scroll up just a little bit, you can see that this packet, if I come over here to the TCP length, this shows me that there's no encapsulated data. So there's actually nothing being sent in this SYN from a data perspective. But if I come up here and I start talking about the TCP SYN ACK, we're going to notice if we come down to the acknowledgement number, right here, we can see that the SYN ACK in the opposite direction is actually acknowledging an acknowledgement number 1. So what this is it's actually something that we call a ghost byte. So in the handshake process, each side will acknowledge one, you could call it a ghost byte. It's not an actual real byte of data. But the two SYNs will act as if there is a ghost byte. So again, the SYN is just sending with no data, but the SYN ACK comes back and it acts this ghost byte. And then you can notice, which we'll talk about in just a minute, that the acknowledgement from the client back to the server acknowledges a ghost byte, or it behaves as if there was a byte sent in the SYN ACK. So that's something to know as we see these acknowledgement numbers and sequence numbers start to increment. Okay, so in the opposite direction, here we see the SYN ACK. All right, so let's go ahead and take a look at the header values besides what we just talked about, the acknowledgement number here in this opposite direction. So here we see that this is coming from port 80. It's going to 54.433, so it's responding back to that same port number that the client started sending from, and that high number client-side ephemeral port. And if we come down in the opposite direction, here's our SYN ACK. So here we can see the SYN bit is set and the acknowledgement bit is set. So this is ACKing, that ghost byte, so to speak. So it's ACKing, and it's also opening its own SYN. So it too, the server, is sending a starting sequence number. That's that 4-byte long value that Wireshark will set to 0 for us, just to make it easy to see. And it's ACKing the ghost byte that was sent. or not sent, that's the wrong way to say it, but you know what I mean. It's behaving as if it's acknowledging one byte. Okay, so if we keep moving, our window size value from the server, here's 4380, that's the starting number. And if we come down and take a look at the options, we can see that the maximum segment size is 1460. 1460, these two are good to go. The window scale, now the server is saying window scale multiply by 1. So shift count 0, multiplier 1. So basically what that means is we're going to take this window size value and multiply it by 1. So in other words, the window side isn't really, it is using window scaling, but it's not using a value that will increase this number, giving us a calculated window size. So if we keep going, here's our TCP SAC. So both sides are permitting it. So we'll go ahead and use TCP SAC. So here's our SYN acknowledgement. Now the final packet in the three-way handshake, here's our acknowledgement. It's coming from the client. And we come down, we can see that the sequence number is 1. The reason being, again, that ghost byte that the server was acknowledging in the SYN ACK, that's the number that we will start from. That tells us that things are working and starting up properly. Also, the acknowledgement number we're sending back to the server that we, again, we're behaving as if there was a byte sent just to get that number going. Also, here's our acknowledgement. We do not send a SYN bit in the final ACK here, the third packet of the three-way handshake. There's no SYN bit set. This is just a simple ACK. We can see the window size, and with that scale factor that was initially sent in the SYN from the client, the true window size is 17520. The window size scaling factor is 4. And just a note for you, it's really important to capture the TCP handshakes, and this is one reason why. If we did not capture the TCP handshake for this connection, we would not know what the true scaling factor is. We would have no idea that the true window is 17520. We would think that the window size value is 4380 from the client. So that's another reason why it's so important to catch TCP handshakes if possible, because we can actually calculate the true window, which Wireshark will do for us. As we can see, the TCP options are gone. Those are only exchanged during the SYNs, and now we are ready to start exchanging data. Now, something else that's very useful in capturing a TCP handshake is we can get the initial round-trip times. So if we come back up and take a look at the delta times between these packets up on top here, we can see the SYN, and we can see that 74 milliseconds, almost 75 milliseconds later, we see a SYN ACK. Now, for this trace file, this was actually captured client-side, so we can see that the initial round-trip time is 74. If we were capturing on the server or near the server, we shouldn't capture on the server. I don't want to get in trouble with anybody. If we're capturing near the server, then we would actually see this value between the SYN ACK and the ACK, right? So the SYN would come in from the client. We would immediately see a SYN ACK go out, and then we would see an ACK come back from the client. And that's where we would see our 74 milliseconds. Now, if we're somewhere in the middle, let's just say we're not on client or server side, well, then what we can do is we can actually add these two numbers together. Add the delta time between the SYN and SYN ACK, and also add the delta time between the SYN ACK and the ACK, and that will give us our initial network round trip time, regardless if we're in the dead center of those two endpoints. So that's just a little trick to keep in mind. Okay, so I hope this video was useful to you in capturing and interpreting and learning more about the TCP handshake process. We look forward to digging further into TCP in further videos. Thanks for stopping by, and everyone, have a great day.